Money's gotta be the shoes.
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 You sure it's not the shoes?
My illmatics and reasonable doubters who hung out on corners at unreasonable hours. My full-time niggas that keep a season of what hours. Chief and sour with the Keef, only time that I sprinkle powder. At the Four Seasons, I'm with a freak like a Dina Howard. But time is money, I think I'm leaving in like an hour. With goals big as the Freedom Tower, we've reaching hours. But brush your teeth before you could think about speaking about us. Good morning.
Wish good. Y'all are tuned in to the Off the Top podcast, the premiere episode hosted by yours truly, Kill, my brother Yao. Jeez, what's going on, Yao?
What's up, man? How you doing, Kill? What's going on, man? How you
man,
doing,
everything is good. B, how can I complain? We've been talking about this podcast forever. We setting it off, so I'm excited. We got my brother, our first guest for the premiere episode, my brother. The Illadelph legend, the owner of one of the most slept on albums that I consider in hip hop history, Many Faces, my brother Tracey. What's going on, good brother?
Stop it. You're too kind, bro. You're too kind. All is well on this side, man. You know, just feeling the vibes and enjoying the family and all that good stuff, man. So glad to be here.
No doubt. Now, somebody out there, prayerfully, you rock with Apartment 5B. You may be saying, what's the difference between this and Apartment 5B? Here's the thing. Yao is one of the few people, and I know a lot of people, but he's one of the very few people that I know who I can go into depth about three topics. That's hoops, that's hip-hop, and that's sneakers. I'm talking about, we could sit here and talk about playground legends from Harlem, Philly, Detroit. We could talk about NBA, college, whatever. Like, there are times on the podcast, I'll be like, yo, none of y'all probably ever heard of this boy Marty Collins used to hoop for Temple. And Yao was like, what are you talking about, Marty Collins? I know Marty Collins. Like, so, those are three things that we can always talk about. So the whole topic of Off the Top is going to be, I've got three questions for him about hoops, basketball, and kicks. He has no idea what they are, vice versa. So this is what we're hearing for the first time. So everything's going to be off the top. Yeah, why don't you set us off with the first question you got for us? Okay. What category are we going with first?
We're going to start off with hoops, you know what I'm saying? Being that, you know, scrimmages just started in the NBA. So right. I want to get something like that. You know, I'm a big hoop fan. Everybody knows me knows that. I play hoops still to this day. So my first question for you, Kill, is I want to know, what's the first pro and or college basketball game you ever attended live?
First pro game. Here's the wild part, man.
Nice.
I want to say, yeah. He's taking me back off the top. I know my uncle took me to a Sixers game like back in like 89, 88, 89. You know what I mean? My pop wasn't a big basketball fan, so I didn't even like really get in the hoops until I think it's 88, 89 when the Lakers played the Pistons and they won.
Gotcha.
I've always been the underdog type boy, so I was like, okay, I'm going to be a Bad Boys Pistons fan since they lost or whatever like that. So yeah. I want to say that, but I know offhand the after that was my mentor took me to an Atlanta Hawks game when I lived in Atlanta back in 97. He treated me to a game out there. So that was my first pro game. First college game, I didn't even get on to college until really, really hard in 97. I want to say the first college game was I took Naomi to a Georgetown UConn game out here at the Verizon Center. She was like probably two or three because it was just me and her. So that's a good one, bro. Because I have no idea. Trey, what about you? What was your first college or pro game?
I was just sitting up here thinking about that. For those that don't know, I was raised in Philly, right? But I was born in Buffalo, New York, right?
Word.
And okay. So I remember, you know, I think this was the first, but this is back in the day when Bob McAdoo and Ernie Dandridge used to play for the Buffalo Braves.
The Braves.
And this is, and for those who don't know who the Braves are, they eventually went out west and became the LA Clippers. You see what I'm saying? So I recall, I think in 74, I went to a game with Bob McAdoo, who back then, for those who don't know, he eventually ended up with the Lakers, won a couple of rings with them. But he went to North Carolina, and this dude was an absolute animal. He led the league in scoring. He's a two-time NBA scoring champ. You know what I'm saying? Like, I think it's 73 and 74. He averaged like 28, 29 a game. Yeah. I mean, buckets, automatic. So I think that was the first one. I thought it was the Globetrotters. I went to see the Globetrotters when I was like 8. But I think that was the first one.
Crazy. Right. Not to go off tangent, but a little story I heard about Bob McAdoo recently, probably like the last 10 years. You know, he was assistant coach for the Miami Heat for a little while.
Yeah, absolutely.
And you know, there was a stretch there where I think D-Wade was hurt and they didn't really have a good year. Mm-hmm. And McAdoo's probably like in his late 50s practicing with the guys. Practicing some of the
Oh, so he's still in shape.
Still in shape. And apparently was killing some of these kids one-on-one to the point where Pat Riley came from the front office and said, yo, listen, Bob. You gotta fall back. You're killing these kids confidence.
Right.
I mean, like, relax.
Buckets, man. Buckets.
Yeah.
Buckets.
So my first game I ever went to, I grew up in New Jersey. The first game I ever went to was a Celtics Nets game. I was 5 years old. This is the height of like Larry Bird. Larry Bird Celtics coming off a championship in '86. I went to a Nets Celtics game when I was 5. My dad, at least back then, was really into hoops. I can remember he always tells me stories about me just like popping in front of the TV at age 3, just like looking at the screen and watching the game. Not even sure what I'm watching. Just like I just couldn't take my eyes off it. You know what I mean? So
right.
When I was 5, my first college game, when I was in high school, I went to a Temple and St. Joe's game.
Those games, crazy.
And I'm mad, Big Five. I think I want to say like 2 years later they ended up playing at Celestia, but I ended up leaving high school and I was already at college. And I've probably been to Celestia before. I think I've been to Celestia one time before. So
now, when you went to that game, was Delonte West? Were they hooping then?
No, that was Delonte was going to college. This is like this is like right after like who was the Temple back then?
Back then you had Aaron, Eddie.
Oh, okay. That's what it is. It was Lynn Greer days.
The Lynn Greer days.
Yeah.
Lynn Greer, monster.
Lefty.
Oh, Lynn Greer is crazy.
People don't know about Lynn Greer, ENS out of Philly.
Yes, indeed.
Yo, could shoot the lights out. The only bad thing was he was an Iverson type boy. He was short. He really needed to be a two guard. He was a two guard in a point guard's body, and that just didn't translate in the NBA. But and when he was at Temple, buckets all the time.
Can I interject before we move on? Since you mentioned your first college game, I'd be remiss if I didn't mention this because it was historic, right? But I didn't know it at the time. So my first college game actually was NCAA Final Four in Philly in 1981. And I'm going to tell you the people that was in that building that night. There was Ralph Sampson.
Oh, wow.
There was James Worthy.
Oh, wow.
There was Isaiah Thomas. And then there was a number 8 seed out of Louisiana, LSU, that was like the Cinderella during that time. But, I mean, come on, man. Ralph Sampson, James Worthy, and Isaiah Thomas.
So you're talking Houston, North Carolina, and Indiana.
No, we talking Indiana, we're talking North Carolina, and we're talking Virginia.
My bad, Virginia. I'm thinking Houston, NBA.
Yep, and so that was amazing that night. That was amazing. Yeah. Got bumped. LSU upset Virginia and wound up playing. Four. Exactly.
Yeah.
Wound up playing Indiana. And Indiana won the whole joint.
Yo, that's crazy. And while we on the palestra for 2 seconds, man, one of the dopest games I went to. This was LeBron's senior year. he came down from St. Vincent, played at the Palestra, and played up against Strawberry Mansion against Maurice Rice, who at the time was one of the nicest high school players in the nation. And
I want to. He got buckets,
but I mean, it was Brian. It was Brian in his senior year. But I mean, the Palestra, if you've never been, folk out there, is one of the dopest spots in Philly to ever, in the world to me, to go see basketball. I mean, it was an amazing, you know, thing to just be there. And the Palestra, mom's got me like courtside seats, so me and my man was right there. So very, very dope spot. Dope question, yeah. I'll stay on the hoops joint for y'all. Tell me this. You get to take one coach out to dinner and ask one question. What coach is it? It could be any type of coach. It could be you could do Tiny, who used to coach Lincoln back when Bassie was there, and I think Steph's in here. You could do Mousy from the Terror Squad, Rucker years. You could do, you know, Phil Jackson. But what is one coach that you would want to take out to dinner, and what would be the question you would ask that coach?
Wow. That's a good-ass question.
I'll go first. Who you asking?
You can go first.
I would like to take Mark Jackson to dinner.
Dope.
I really want the skinny on. I can speculate. I heard rumors and all sorts, but I would really like to know what happened, because to me, he, and I don't care what anyone says, he is responsible for that dynasty that happened in San Francisco / Oakland. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
He is the one that handpicked those players and really created the monster that they became. You know, of course, you had Durant later and all that other stuff. But, you know, he instilled the confidence. He instilled the mindset. I really want to know what happened. Was it the relationship with the players? Was it front office? Was it like, what really? And to the point where we don't see his name coming up in any type of vacancies to this day.
There's a lot to that. I've heard a lot of things. Just being in the sports industry, I've heard a lot of things in regards to that. We can talk about that offline, but yeah, bro. Like,
I want to know. Do we got to talk about it offline?
Right. I mean,
give me a nugget or something.
They're saying that, like, he has a tendency to kind of like pit players against each other unfairly and make them hate each other, which I think is probably a technique from a competition standpoint for him, maybe. But, you know, it wasn't well received. He also like was doing that with coaches as well. Like, he didn't like coaches feel like assistant coaches feeling like they had too much authority. Is another thing I heard. Also, he was, you know, he's really big into religion.
That's the main one I heard. Yeah.
And he was kind of trying to like force like his religious beliefs on the team. Another thing is, you know, I think one of the front office guys, I believe that one of the front office guys is LBGT. I think he's gay. I believe so. And, you know, being a Christian, I think Mark Jackson was vehemently against that. And that didn't sit right at the front office either. So I think there's some disconnect with that as well. You know what I mean? So there's a whole lot of things. Like I said, these are things that I just heard from floating around. You know, when you're in the industry, you know, these things is kind of just passed through in conversation. You know what I mean? So, you know what I mean? But, you know, like I said, and I'm not sure how valid these are, but these are the things that have been spoken about when his name comes up in conversation. So,
no doubt.
Yeah.
Appreciate that nugget.
Hey, man, look, I do what I can. You know what I mean? For me, can I pick two?
Yeah, go ahead. Knock yourself out.
All right. I'm going to pick one. I would pick PJ Carlissimo. And I would ask him, what did you say to Latrell Sprewell? To make him want to quote
you. Right. Quote me. I want the quote. I want the actual quote.
Verbatim. I need it verbatim.
Because fam, for, do you know what kind of, what you have to say to someone to, for him to want to like wring your neck and choke you? Like,
facts.
Like, what did you say to that man? I would like to know. I want to know. And, I would take Pat Riley out to dinner because we're gonna have a cool ass time, and I do need to ask him a question about why he decided to play John Stark so long in that game 7
against Houston.
Yeah. I like, and it's not even no shade. I would just like to know the
story. Right.
You know what I mean? I would really like to know, like, what was the thought process behind it? Because I know you always go down with your killers, but like, it's game seven. You had a couple vets on the bench. You had Rolando Blackman on the bench. You know what I mean? He wasn't having a good game, but he was riding with his guns. But I would like to know, like, exactly what he was thinking during that moment in game seven.
If I may interject, I think it's because he had a hell of a third quarter. He shot the light that third quarter. He was extraterrestrial in that third quarter.
No, Trey, he wasn't. I'm telling you, not in game seven. In game six, John Starks was buckets, but he couldn't find the ocean in game seven.
Yeah, that's what it was. My bad. I'm sorry. Yeah, it was game six. It was game six. He was like 3 for 20 something in game seven, right?
Game 2 for 18.
That shit is
ingrained. That's right there.
Bruh.
Yo, here's the funny part. I can't remember what book it was, but I remember. Y'all know Jeff Van Gundy was the assistant coach at the time, and Jeff said he asked Pat, like, yo, are we gonna sit him down? And Pat was like, nah, you know, he got us here. We rocking, we was sinking or swimming with him. He's the one who got us here. We gotta just rock. You know what I mean? And that it kind of just ended like that.
I mean, this is game seven and it's still close. Like who you gonna rock with?
As a young boy, right? I'm just like, yo, you just trying to exhaust all options. You know what I mean? You just trying to figure out, like, yo, nah, if he's not working out, we gotta use somebody else. But as you get older, you realize, like, yo, you kind of gotta roll with your guns. You know what I mean? Even when you playing fantasy sports, one thing I learned in fantasy sports, right? When you get to that last them playoff rounds, if you playing fantasy football, they always say, like, yo, roll with your guys. Don't take any chances here. Roll with your guys, because these are the guys you've been trusting in the whole year. You mm-hmm. don't wanna, you make a mistake, and let's say you take Brett Favre out and replace him for, I don't know, fucking Brian Hoyer. It's a better matchup. You know what I mean? Like, you can't do that. You got to roll with your guys. Looking back at it, it's like, yeah, roll with your guys, but it's like, in a game.
At that time.
I couldn't fathom it. You know what I mean? It was a tough stretch for me. Definitely a tough stretch for me as a fan. You know what I mean? So still to this day.
Yeah, that's crazy. That's crazy. But that's a good question, Trey, because I never asked a Knicks fan, who would you have brought off the bench?
Yeah,
who would you have went with?
They have Rolando Blackman. You know what I mean? Who is at that point the vet?
Long at the tooth. He's long at the tooth at the time.
Long at the tooth. But one thing you know about him, he's a vet. He's a professional. And if he's open, he's going to make a jump shot. You know what I mean? And really, if you look, here's the thing. And this is what I keep saying. We really just needed one. We needed one. One or two. Because, we lost the game by 6 points.
Right.
And John Starks went 2 for 18. You know what I mean?
Yeah, like, yeah. Y'all closed the gap at the end. You know what I'm saying?
One or two jump shots to go during the game just to make it like, right,
I blame that. You know what though? I blame that squarely on the shoulders of Pat Ewing.
No, we're not doing that. We're not doing.
You know why? You know why? Because that's your leader. That's your guy. That's your guy.
Trey, here's the wild part. Now say this. It's not slander. It's just. I mean, Ewing is the guy. Like,
that's your guy. That's your guy.
My thing is,
he acted like Starks was the dude, but he wasn't the dude.
No, okay. Ewing is your guy.
Okay, and that's all well and good. I hear that. But if Ewing is your guy, are you making sure that John Starks is taking 18 shots during the biggest game of the year? That's what I'm saying.
Okay, so you're going back to the coach then?
Coach. That's what I'm saying.
But here's the thing. To me, it's Pat saying, nigga, calm the fuck down and get me to rock.
I didn't want to say it.
If the coach ain't saying it, it's like, Pat, yo, Starks, come the fuck
you
over
think,
here.
Hold on. You think Akeem on the other side is like, bro, telling Kenny Smith, yeah, go ahead and shoot the joint 18 times.
I have heard plenty of stories of Pat in the huddle like, yo, get me the ball. And it was like, nah, listen, we're gonna roll with it.
See, and that's Pat's fault. You know why? Because I'm what? What do you mean, no?
What Pat you talking about? Pat Riley or Pat Ewing?
Pat Ewing. That's Ewing. Pat Ewing. Like, yeah. No. What? No, you're not. We're going to what? Man.
It's tough, man.
See, this is the thing when we start talking about, like, the greats of the greats and the leaders and all this other stuff. You know what I mean? That was the only knock. The Knicks should have been a dynasty. But I always got to point to.
I don't believe that.
Who was the leader?
Yo, man.
Look. I think the hard part with the Knicks is you ran into Jordan, and it was just like during those years, like
they could have beat Jordan. No, they had Jordan on the rope so many times, man.
Trey, hear me out. Let me ask you a question. I know people say this about Patrick Ewing all the time, like how he fell short. But let me ask you this: who is the best player Patrick Ewing has ever played with in his playoff runs?
The best one he's ever played with?
The best player he's ever played with.
He had a lot of good players.
Did he have
a clear number two, is what you're saying?
It would be John Starks, which is not a superstar.
John Starks made one All-Star game while he was in the NBA.
No, I'm going to tell you who they had. I stand by this on everything. Okay, so you're a Knicks fan. So you should know this. Like, this should be...
I have an idea as to where you're going. You're either going with Rob Strickland or Mark Jackson. Neither one of them.
Nah. Neither one of them. I'm going with Xavier McDaniel.
I also agree with that. They should have kept him. He was a dog. I don't know what. I don't know.
I'm gonna tell you what happened. Xavier McDaniel was the only guy on that Knicks team
who would stand up
to Jordan. He was not budging. I'm gonna tell you how cutthroat Xavier McDaniel. I know we're getting off subject.
But no.
It was the night I went. It was the night I went to the party to the joint that big his untimely demise that night. Right, I was going to that party in L.A. Xavier McDaniel's in underneath the joint. We about to go in. His son is out there. His son is like, oh snap, that's Tracey Lee. Da 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 da. All of a sudden, I hear, boy. Get your ass over here. I said, yo, who's that? I looked over. I was like, oh, it's the X-Man. I said, oh, it's just the X. He was talking straight to his son. He's like, don't you ever hop on another nigga dick like that. Don't ever do that. So I had flashbacks of when I saw this man on the court. Xavier McDaniel didn't give a shit about nobody. Dog. Nobody. And he'll give you 25 a game. So here's the point. So game 7... Right? Was that ninth of Jordan and them second ring? What was that? 92.
We had them
that year. That right? So I'm thinking, okay, they lost game 7. They're gonna come back next year. They're gonna bust their ass.
And all we needed to do was keep X-Man. That's all we had to do.
News flash: X-Man and Jordan have the same agent, David Falk. The very next year, they shipped X-Man out to the worst team in the league, which at that time was the Boston Celtics. And you never heard from X-Man again. After him giving the Knicks about 24, 25 a game, prior to that in Seattle, giving them 20-something a game, and after that series, after the world saw that X-Man didn't give a shit about Jordan, he ships them off. Same agent.
They got rid of that man, bro. It was tough.
Same agent. Think about that.
Yeah, no doubt. Damn.
Knicks talk kind of every time I get to Knicks talk.
So I didn't mean to take that off.
Not at all.
I'm fucking with you. I do this all day, right? I do this all day.
I love it. For me, at first, when I thought of this question, I was like getting all deep and introspective and everything. And then I realized, you know, I want to take out the lunch. Brett Brown. I want to ask Brett Brown, how the fuck does it feel to get punked every day of your fucking life because you tell Ben Simmons to take a three every game and he literally ignores you every fucking game? Like, wow. you have put it out for the world to see. This is like, Trey, it's like your whole family coming over for Thanksgiving dinner. You tell your kid, like, yo, curfew is 11 o'clock. Niggas be coming home at 3 in the morning every night. Like, just disregarding everything that you say. Joel Embiid was the one. He was like, yo, Brett is the boy who got me out here taking these threes. I want to be in the paint. So Nobody respects the boy. Nobody throw him under the bus all the time. It's like, yo, bro, like, how does it feel to be constantly disrespected every single day that you open your eyes? How does that feel? How does it feel to know that you have cost my city? I don't know. I feel like if Brett really would have coached and really put in work, I mean, wasn't the whole hoopla, Brett, that him and Ben's pop was cool or something? Or they coached together on the Australian team or something, or whatever it is.
Wow.
Whatever it is just something is just off with Brett Brown. So I just would like to ask, like, yo, man, when are you going to resign? Because it's obvious Elton Brand isn't going to fire you, which I have no idea why. You know what I mean? I'm praying he gets fired this year, but I kind of feel like they'll be like, what was that, half a year? It's not fair. Bring him back another year. I've been wanting Brett Brown fired for 3 fucking years now. 3 years. And I keep seeing him on the sideline. And it's like, what does this man have to do? It's obvious that this team cannot win, man. So, I mean, that's my thing. I would want to know from Brett, how does it feel to just be disrespected every day of your life? Nobody listens to you. Nobody respects you. The whole fucking city hates you. How does that feel, man? I want to know. How does that feel?
Oh, man.
That sounds funny.
I mean, I really want to know.
I feel you, though. I feel you, bro. Like,
I want to know.
He really hasn't. I mean, he hasn't done the job of coaching.
At all.
You know what I mean? He just hasn't.
I mean, Ben Simmons hasn't gotten better. To me, Joel hasn't gotten better. And to me, it all comes back to the coach. Like, who are you holding accountable?
And play, you know what I mean? You know what I mean? That's what it comes down to. So, I mean, we'll see. Elton's got. I mean, it's going to be tough to get rid of him this year because of the whole half a year thing. You know what I mean?
Right, which I feel like we stuck again.
Yeah, particularly if y'all like, I will say this, though. Y'all lose first round, all bets are off.
Yeah. To be honest, this is to me the closest year we can win a chip. Right.
I was about to say that. This is
the best chance just based off the fact we don't shoot no threes. So it ain't even like nobody gotta get back in rhythm. You know what I mean?
And I like the coaching. I like the move with Ben going to power forward.
I'm scared about that because Ben's never played power forward. Ben doesn't have a post game. He's been a point guard his whole life.
Well, we know that the game now is not really, it's a positional game. So, but just the mere fact that you got another person on the floor that can actually spread the floor, shoot the ball, you know what I'm saying? And if he does go down there, that can get him, you know, some touches down there because he's going to be better than probably 90% of the power forwards that are going to be guarding him, especially if they got to go out on the perimeter. You know what I'm saying? So I kind of like that move. And it creates more spacing. So now you don't got the two big guys on the floor. Even when Horford can shoot, he's not generally out on the perimeter. Now you got four perimeter guys and Embiid got enough space to do work. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
If he stays his big ass down there like he's supposed to and not play guard or shooting guard like he wants to. You know what I'm saying?
My thing has always been, bro, you got to give me a double-double. Then you can shoot threes. I know that shit look cool, but you got to at least give me 10 and 10. You give me 10 and 10, now you can go and try to roam and do what the fuck you want to do.
He is unstoppable. He's unstoppable down there. I don't know why he doesn't understand that. Nobody can guard him down there.
Everybody wants to shoot threes, man. All right, yeah, what's your next question for us, man? What category are we going with?
Our next question, we're going to go hip-hop.
All right.
All right. So there's a Philly cypher going on.
Ooh.
Mm.
I got four of the toughest Philly rappers of all time. Cypher big rappers. You got Siegel. You got Black. You got Cassidy. You got Petey Crack. Who gonna have the best verse walking out of here? One verse apiece. We're gonna do the Payton Full beat.
I say this for me, man. I say this all the time. There's no knock on thought. For me, it's going to be Siegel, man. Siegel just speaks my language to me more than Thought does. You know, Thought is going to be, if you want somebody to rhyme for 8.5 hours and the breath control is there and everything is there, it's going to be Thought. But for me, it's going to be Siegel. Siegel's going to have some of them joints that make you go, ooh. Like, it's going to be like, yo, did that nigga, that's going to be you tapping your man like, yo, that nigga said da-da-da-da-da. Like, Thor is gonna be so fast. It's like he like the Flash. Like that nigga like is like the Flash to me on the Justice League. Like, you know, the Flash is an ill nigga, but nigga, you so fast, niggas can't keep up with you. You know what I mean? Like that freestyle you did on Hot 97, incredible. I probably can't quote you but two or three joints from that. You know what I mean? The spitting game is incredible. So if that's what you're into, boom, you're gonna pick Thor. But to me, Siegel is gonna have some nasty, some nasty shit that just makes me go like, what do you say on one of the joints? I'm built for the truck, but I look good in the coupe. Like, it's like he's gonna say some shit, you know, we say salt, pepper, and hot sauce, or Lucy in a bag of chips. He's gonna say that hood shit that takes me back to Ogun's Avenue in Philly. That's gonna make me understand that. Thor is gonna black out. Cassidy, we talking Cassidy 98, Battle Freeway Cassidy, he's gonna hit you with some crazy bars.
I think Cassidy hits with some shit down. I think Cassidy's still in pocket right now. I know people
Them last two battles I seen in Cassidy was not flattering.
Here's the thing about battle, and I have to go on tangent again, but the battle game now was way different from the battle game that Cassidy came up with. You know what I mean? Like, in the last two battles, Cassidy didn't really show that he has adjusted to this new era battle. Like, it's not just the bars, it's not just the delivery. You got to engage the crowd. It's about being a showman.
It's theater, man.
It's art. And nobody's saying that Cass ain't nice. Cass one of the nicest to ever do it. To me, as far as if you throw a nigga in a cipher, Cass one of the nicest. You know what I mean? Like, I still watch that seven minute verse he got on YouTube. I watch that shit like once a month, just because, you know what I mean. I'm just a huge fan of Philly cipher rappers. It's always been my thing. But like, he didn't adjust well to that new battle. So of course he got smoked. To me, I mean, I don't know if it's like, I don't know why people are even trying to like take up for him. Like, took the L. It is what it is. You know what I mean? But
plain and simple.
Yeah. So yeah. I got beans. Trey, who you got?
I got Thought, man. I love Beans though. Don't get it twisted. Beans is special. You know what I mean? Beans is a special guy. Like we talked about, you know, on Apartment 5B, John. Beans started a wave. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. When you influence, you know, people like that, man, you're special. Beans is special, but Thought is, he's one of maybe about three MCs that I know that have come from my era or before, mm-hmm. and actually gotten better.
Yeah.
This dude is, and how do you get better from back then? Like, he was treacherous back then. So it's like, I mean, he's on some rap
Jedi type shit.
Yeah.
Like the fact that he's still like, he's remarkably in pocket, and he's wordplay. He's incredibly sharp. He's sharp, bro. It's really ridiculous. Like,
it is.
Let me ask a question. And again, for everybody watching, this is no Thought slander. This is no knock on Thought. As people, we all have people, things that we like. But here's my question. Can Thought make a good song, though?
Nah, we're not. You said...
You know what? That's my fault. You said cypher. Yep. You said cypher. So we totally off topic. Yep. That's my bad.
Hey, Trey was going to get him. Look.
That's something totally different. You know what I mean?
That's my fault.
I'm imagining. We somewhere on Broadneary in a circle.
Right,
and
you're right.
Computers
you're
on, right. Yeah. And Cass is just doing it. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, you're right.
In the Bubble Gooses and the Thames and you know what I mean? Like, I'm picturing that and just da 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 da. You know what I mean? And I'm like, woo! With the Dennis Edwards, you know what I mean? With the painful John and the woo.
Yeah.
That's what
I'm thinking. You're right. Dead to right. Who you got, so,
I'm actually going to take PD Crack here, bro. I like that. For me, I just feel like, to me, in Cypher raps, I don't think there's not too many guys in the world who have done, who do that better than PD Crack. I feel that. Like, the way he switches up flows and his wordplay and his voice, like, it's just, not only that, also, it all depends, it also kind of depends on what order he's in. Because I feel like if PD was to start the Cypher off, it wouldn't come off as well. But if he comes after, like, Siegel and hit you, all of a sudden you hear that voice change, it's like, it's PD Crack. And all of a sudden it's like, now I'm hype. precision flow for him, yo. Just like timing every single time. You know what I mean?
And his tone cuts through.
It cuts through. You know what I mean? So and it's all clever, like slick nigga bars. You know what I mean? Like I fuck with that's my era. Like him,
right?
You know what I mean? Like slick nigga. Like I'm that nigga, but I'll still pop off on you. You know what I mean? Like,
right. That type of shit.
Here's the crazy thing. If y'all can see that Welcome to Crack's House. That mixtape right there, I was just working out to this last night. If folk out there are like, yo, PD, like what? I'm telling you, go to this crack, welcome to the tough. Crack House.
Crack House is man. Tough, and crack files is tough.
Yo, just in case for anybody out there like PD, because I know there's somebody who's like PD, because if you're not a real digger, like you're not going to really even know PD like that, but PD is a problem.
Honestly, Petey was supposed to be that next boy.
Yeah, but he got locked up.
That's the reason why Def Jam hung on to that. That's the reason why Def Jam put some money and put him on features and all that kind of stuff because he was going to be that boy.
Yeah, it's funny. The one thing about Philly rappers, man, we get locked up a lot. That's the problem.
Y'all
you know, Roscoe P. Goldchain, who was down with Pharrell, oh my God, was about to be a problem. Got knocked Siegel, up. You know Siegel what I mean? Single. Knocked up. Cassidy. Locked up. Like, it's something about Philly boys, man. We don't leave the hood, man. And I used to tell Cass that. That's my young boy. Cass live up literally across the street from me, man. I open my door, I can see his mom's house. Like, you know what I mean? So just a sad situation.
Yeah, man.
All right. With hip hop, let me go to this because I actually got two questions for y'all. Let me ask y'all the first question. Trey, your first single off the new album, Glory, that's dropping next Friday, July 31st. Mm-hmm. You've got this line, and let me say this. Let me take a second and say this. One, Trey, I salute you again for everything that you did opening up the remix competition for producers to be able to get in. Remix the single, and then also to have you and Google on IG for 5 hours.
Absolutely.
Critiquing every single remix, giving really great constructive criticism, not just "nah, I was all right, next one," like literally taking 10, 15 minutes for each remix. So I want to thank you for that.
No problem, brother.
I did a remix. I had my brother Yao here jump on it. So he's got a piece of his verse I want to talk about. It's your verse. You say, "When I look at my daughter's, I see Breonna Taylor. When I look at my daughter's eyes, I see Breonna Taylor."
Yeah.
That verse hit me because, of course, I have a daughter too. But where did that line come from? And I mean, I can guess where it comes from. But when you're writing, how did that, what made you take it there with that line about your daughter's eyes?
Well, I'm going to go to the line before that. I said the cross bearer of the modern era. Because when I look at my daughter, I see Breonna Taylor. Meaning, I'm going to be the cross bearer for the sake of my daughter because I don't want my daughter to end up how Breonna Taylor ended up, and she can very well be Breonna Taylor. You see what I'm saying?
Right.
Being a black woman in America and somebody, you know, the cops invade her home and just shoot her. You see what I'm saying?
Right.
So, you know, just the understanding, the realization of that happening, it's frightening. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
So I'm going to do everything that I can. I will bear the cross to make sure that she doesn't end up like that. You know what I'm saying? And it was really as simple as that, man. Anytime, you know, our brothers and sisters, our young brothers and sisters out there are being eaten alive, you know what I'm saying, by the system, you know, it's like, man, it's gut-wrenching. It takes a lot.
Right.
It takes a lot out of you. You know what I mean? And so, you know, the immediate thing that you can do, at least in my eyes, is to protect your own and then protect, you know, people that look like you. So it's like, I'm willing to do whatever it is I got to do to make sure that my immediate family, in particular, my daughter is protected. You know what I'm saying? So that's where that came from.
That's dope. Yo, the funny thing about that, bro, this had to be years ago because this is right after Mike Brown got murdered in Ferguson. So this may be 2014. Mm-hmm. And I'm in Philly. I got Maryland plates. Cop pulls me over. Naomi's in the back seat. Headphones on, reading a book. So she's like oblivious. Cop comes over to me. He's like, "Yo, where you coming from?" And I was shocked. Like, "Yo, not no license, registration. Like, where you coming from?" I'm like, "Oh, I was coming from the suburbs. I'm seeing my man. Where you about to go now?" "About to go down South Street." "Well, who you mean down South Street?" Like, this dude is doing all this, you know. any guns or drugs in the car? I'm like, nah, I got my daughter in the back seat with me. Like, nah, I wouldn't do that. Back and forth, bro. Yo, he had me out there for at least an hour, an hour and change. Wow. And at this point, I'm like, yo, I'm going to jail. Like, I already know that. My only concern is, you know, T is still down here in Maryland. I'm like, what are you gonna do with my daughter? You know what I mean? Because if it's 4 years ago, I guess Naomi's maybe 7 or 8. So I'm like, what, his child? You know, so I'm just bugging off of that. So he comes over to the car, you know, one last time. Are you sure there's no drugs or weapons in the car? I'm like, nah. He looks at me, looks at Naomi, looks at me. He's like, okay, you can leave. Now, I mean, I've been sitting here for an hour and change. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. I pull over. I'm down north. I'm right off Kelly Drive. And I pull over maybe about a mile further down, just break down crying. Like, you know, and the funny thing is I'm like, God, thank you that I have a daughter and that I don't have a son. Because if I had a son, I would have to explain to him what is going on, even at this early age of 7 to 8. And then a couple of months later, Sandra Bland happens. And it's just like,
wow.
It's like, you know, at least for me at first, it was like, okay, fuck it. The black man, I'll take the hit. You know, as long as it don't affect my wife, my mom, my daughter. But then with Sandra Bland, it was just like, fuck it. We all just targets. You know what I mean? So I think that's why that line stuck out to me I feel it, you know, because like you said, you're talking about a sister who was just in her crib, sleep, like not doing nothing.
Showing.
You know, because you're always trying, well, for me, I'm always trying to find a pocket. Like, well, what could I have done? Well, maybe if I wasn't in that part of town, you in your crib. There's nothing else you can't do. Like, you know what I mean? So I think that's why I love that line so much. Yeah, your line was on some old Kanye, Austin Powers type line. Like when he was like, George Bush don't care about black people. You know what I mean? You send me your verse and I hear, fuck the NFL and Roger Goodell until they sign Cap. Mm. And I'm like, yo, you know what I mean? Now, for people out there who may not know, I worked at ESPN. Yeah, I used to do the intro Sunday for NFL show. So I'm like, yo, so to hear Yao say that, I'm like, like, damn, this is the boy that used to intro the NFL show every Sunday for ESPN. So I mean, where did that come from for you to even, because I'm like, be pissed. This nigga said fuck Roger Goodell in the NFL.
That even makes it resonate even more. It's like, woo.
Yeah. I mean, first and foremost, like, it is rhyming at the end of the day. It's rapping. You know what I mean? Like, when you get the rhyme first, sometimes it might not even be like a thought. I was just thinking of like a rhyme scheme, and I was like, okay. And I was like, nah, fuck Roger Goodell. You know what I mean? Like, because this whole thing that happened could have been avoided had you decided to take a stand. Let me not say it could have been avoided, but the fact that y'all are copping pleas now, even though Kaepernick had to go through hell and high water to go through this whole shit. Like, he spent his whole last year, y'all was in his locker room asking him questions, then y'all put like an order, like a secret order not to sign him, stay away from the guy. Then you guys realized you guys were getting bad press, you decided you were gonna give him a tryout in which he couldn't have his own people there, couldn't have his own media there to tape it. Right. So you guys were going to finagle this thing to make it seem like he wasn't ready to play. So you guys have been like finagling the system to try to make it seem bad. And all of a sudden, when all of this shit happens and the country's in unrest and all the rest of the leagues and the teams are coming up with statements, you decide, oh, you know what? We're really bothered by what's going on here.
Right.
No. Essentially, fuck you. You know what I mean? Until you right your wrongs, and this is for anything, like, and I know this country has an issue with like not like just feeling like it's always entitled to everything, but like, yo, when you fuck up, acknowledge the fuck up. We were wrong. We should sign Kaepernick because we took money out of a man's mouth when he was only doing something that soldiers had fought for.
Right.
Like, you got to think, this whole thing started because people were upset about him kneeling, but it started because he was sitting during the anthem, right? He was sitting. People got upset about that. There was a guy from the I forgot what part of the military. I think I want to say from the army who said, "Hey, white dude, say, hey, you know what? Instead of just sitting down, why don't you kneel? Because that's also a way of showing respect." But nobody heard that. They just was like, "You know what? Black man going against, bucking against the system. We don't like that. fuck you. Then Trump comes out and all, and you were like, it was just too much. So yes, mm-hmm. fuck Roger Goodell and NFL. And mm-hmm. quite honestly, like, I know I've done work for them, but I haven't been into in NFL for like the last couple of years because of all this shit's going on. Also, I felt like my favorite team is, I'm a Giants fan. I felt like they've done a lot of racist shit in the last couple of years that kind of showed face. So I was just like, nah, like, fuck the NFL, right? Until you sign cap, until you right your wrongs, it's fuck y'all. That's how it has. That's how it is in life with anything. You know what I mean? If you get into right. a beef with your man, until you apologize to me, yo, fuck you.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right.
So,
right.
That's what it is.
Hey, man, I love it. I love it. I love it. You know what I mean?
But like I said, those are the two bars that really stood out to me about that joint. So definitely wanted to get into that. Got one more hip-hop question for me. Tell me this, y'all. Who do you think would have won in a battle? Now, whenever I'm talking about battles, I'm talking about these people are at their pinnacle. So this is like, so here's the thing. For some people may not know, Run and LL always had a competition going on behind closed doors. You know what I mean? The word on the street was that LL wanted to use the Mardi Gras Bob James sample that they used for Peter Piper, because they used to call that, right, for Rock the Bells. Because back in the day when you would be, DJs would be spinning in the park, they'd be like, yo, I want to rock the bells. And that meant throw on Mardi Gras where they would do that. Mm-hmm. Run hears that they're about to use that. Run goes to the studio, they use it first before we get to Rock the Bells that we hear. So there was always a competition between those two. So we're talking, I guess, Run at his pinnacle is probably maybe 85, 86 Run. We're talking King of Rock, Raising Hell Run. Trey, I don't know where you would put LL at his pinnacle. Would it be Bad? Would it be Mama Say Knock You Out?
I mean, the thing about L is he came out the gates.
Yeah,
it's
hard with L. You could almost go L pinnacle from radio,
yeah,
to Bad, all the way to Mama Said Knock You. Yeah. I kind of break from some joints on Walking with a Panther. But who do you think would win in that battle? We're just talking about on wax and on stage. So who could make the better diss song? Who could make the better? Who would win on stage?
Me personally, I'm never going against LL in the battle.
There you go.
I'm not doing it.
There you go.
Nope. Like, he's fried too many cats.
Yep.
You know what I mean? Kumo D. You know what I mean?
Ice-T, Hammer. Cannabis, even though some people would say, but I still think he fried Cannabis.
He fried Cannabis, but I mean, if you feel like Cannabis won, the reasons are valid. You know what I mean? And I get that. Right. But it ain't like, it's not a wash.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
It's polarizing a little bit. You were one way or the other. So I get it. But his battle record is stamped. And I'm not. I mean, Run, fine. But in prime, LL Cool J in a battle?
Nobody.
Yeah. No, I'm good.
In prime LL? No. Nobody that ever existed is messing with him.
I'm good.
Yeah.
Nobody. I don't care how lyrical you are. I don't care how your flow is. It's just that there's certain people that are built for certain things and are special in certain ways.
He lives for that shit. He lives for that shit.
Right. Especially when we're talking Pentacle, because to me, one of my favorite diss songs of all time is Jack the Ripper.
Oh, man.
I mean, if you're talking about that, L, you could take that song and put it against anybody else who was out at that time. Yeah. And it's going to be hard to top that Jack the Ripper joint.
Yeah,
so,
I love Run. Don't get it twisted. Yeah. He has the vocal capability to do it, meaning the way we were talking about how person's voices cut through, the tone cuts through, and his vibrato, and his, you know what I'm saying? If you're talking, like, he had certain pieces that could possibly, you know, do some damage, but not against Prime LL. It's not gonna happen.
Right. Nah, I feel you. Yeah, what you got up for us on the kicks front, good brother?
On the kicks front, so I've been on this Air Max kit lately, and I wanted to know, what is your favorite Air Max? Like, for me, I'll just give you mine for right now. So right now, I'm an Air Max 1 guy, but the 97s are still my favorite ones to ever look at. All right, man, hold on. Hold on, kill. Hold on, kill. Let me wipe it. wife don't even know I got another pair.
Yo, I understand, good brother. I understand. Yeah, gotta hide them under the bed. I understand.
What you showing us?
No. I'm just taking out the camos. I'm always the Air Max 90s.
Wow.
I love the 90s. You know what I mean? I love the 90s. I know people love the 95s, but Trey, back in 88 and 89, I used to work at the Foot Locker down 13th and Chestnut.
Okay.
And then I worked at the joint around my way in Shoneham Mall. Okay. So like the Air Max 90s was the first Air Max that I really fell in love with. So like these are just always gonna be my babies. You know what I mean? I love the 95s, but to me, just nothing is doper than a pair of the 90s, man. Yeah. I love those joints, man.
Yeah.
Y'all bringing out the secret stash that's hidden.
I got these right here.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Yeah, I love
nasty.
The comfort of the Air Max 1s are just so comfortable for me, you know what I mean? So like,
yeah.
But as far as a look, 97s, man. I'm a 97 guy, but the ones is what I'm rolling with right now, definitely.
All right, what you got, Trey, Air Max wise?
I mean, I'm not really an Air Max guy, you know what I'm saying?
Okay.
I bounce around when it comes to, you know what I'm saying, my footwear, but if we are talking about just the Nike line in general, you know what I'm saying? Air Maxes are cool. I did have a pair of Air Maxes. I had probably every type of sneaker that has come out, because I was just that person that was trendy from, you know, from the original Dr. J's, the leather joints. Like, I just copped a pair of those that aren't around too much. Not, I'm talking about with the red and the, you know what I'm saying, with the all leather, with the, and you know, from that to the, you know, the Yvon Lindels. I went to Adidas. I went to the you know, of course, the Fila's, the track joints, the Lottos, the
you know, Lottos, man.
What you know about the Lotto, man? What
come on, bro. That was Philly. That was 87, man. That was seventh grade for me, man. Those were some dope days. Cause we could get I used to go to a private school, and Lottos was one of the few kicks that we could wear.
Yeah.
You could get away with them because they was all black.
Yeah.
So I could actually sport them in school instead of having to wear shoes. So hell yeah.
You know the Diodors. I just copped a couple of pairs.
I got a couple of pair of Diodors.
You know what I'm saying?
I love Diodors.
Philly has been really responsible for a lot of my sneaker. Like,
oh yeah.
You know what I mean?
Oh yeah. We get to this.
Nigga, I mean, I had Diodors on one day. I remember I was in North Jersey, and a nigga was clowning me, like, nigga, what are those? I'm like,
what?
Diodors. He's like, nigga, what the fuck are those? I'm like, had me thinking. I was like, wait a minute, am I bugging out? Or like,
but then nah, man.
Then my man from the Bronx came. We came back to school, and he had a pair of black ones on. I was like, nigga, where you get the Diodors from? He was like, I was in Philly on South.
There you go.
Uh-huh. So, I mean, but just to get back on topic, you know what I'm saying? Like I said, I didn't really have, you know, I'm not well-versed in that, particularly in the Air Maxes, but I've always been a fan of those. Don't get it twisted, you know what I'm saying?
What you sipping on, Trey?
Oh, man, I keep it red. It's a little Cabernet, you know what I'm saying?
Okay.
A little Cabernet, you know what I mean?
Nothing fancy.
All right, tell me this, y'all, because this is what I do with albums. I always be like, if you're going to take one album with you on a trip from Philly to Atlanta, New York and Atlanta, you're taking a road trip, what is the most comfortable sneaker for you? You are going to Atlanta. You can only take one pair of sneakers. You're going to be down there for the week. You're going to be walking around. We take this back to Freaknik, 94. You're going to be walking all day, every day. You can only take one pair of sneakers.
That's easy for me. That's easy.
Okay. Well, what you got?
The Reebok Classics, man.
Another Philly staple.
They are between that and the Fila, like the Fila track joints. Those are the most comfortable joints I had 1,000 pair of those, and I still got them right now. So yeah, the Reebok Classic and the track style Fila. I mean the Fila track style sneak and the Reebok Classic.
All right, no doubt. Yeah, what you got?
Jordan 3s.
Mm.
Jordan, here's the thing. What I realize is this. My favorite Jordan in the world is Jordan 4. I tell you all the time. I feel like a superhero when I wear them shits. I just do. Don't ask me why. I just do.
Now tell me where did have to do the right thing? Was this pre-post? Like, was that what made you fall up with it in the bugging out scene?
This is the Craig Elo shot.
Okay.
Ah, yeah.
Okay.
Craig Elo shot. Yeah. And this is my intro to basketball. Not only that, but like I made honor roll. My dad, I think I had seen him before, and my dad said we did them all when sneakers make an honor roll, and I saw them, and I didn't even know they were Jordans. I just saw them when I went on display, and I was like, I want those. Now, in 1989, when your dad lifts up the sneaker and sees it, it's $100.
Oh, yeah.
He's like, $100? Like, the middle of the store. Yeah.
Right.
He was loud as hell. And I was like, yeah, he was like, you better not mess these sneakers up. This is the only pair of sneakers you getting. I was like, damn. Now I'm over here paying $200 every chance I get. $200.
Right.
He was like $100.
Yeah.
But the threes for me, what I realize is them shits are literally an everyday sneaker. Like you walk around, them are just comfortable to walk around in. Like it's the leather on the outside. The inside is comfy. The fours aren't that comfortable. I wear them more for style purposes when I want to flex a little bit. Mm-hmm. But if I want comfort, the threes are just way too comfortable. Me and my homie had a conversation because we literally walked into Dykeman three times in a row. He had his white threes on. I had my black threes on. I was like, yo, why are you always wearing? He's like, yo, they're just so comfy. I throw them on. I walk around. I just feel good in them. You know what I mean? So I would go Jordan threes. Mm.
Yo, the funny thing is, I would have said the threes because that's my favorite sneaker of all time is the threes. But yo, I got a pair of Bordeaux sevens and these Citrus sevens. These may literally be my newest, most comfortable shoe. This may be the lightest Jordan ever. Like, I literally feel like I don't even have shoes on when I'm rocking these sevens. Mm. So I got to go with these, man, because these are just super comfortable. I love, they look dope with a pair of shorts. You get your jeans to lay on them right. Like, you can't go wrong with a pair of sevens. They just comfortable as fuck, man. Like I said, these are just super comfortable.
My Bordeaux sevens got a rip in them, so I had to throw them away. I got a rip like literally on like the side, like just a gash in them, right? They were no good.
How'd that happen, yo?
Bro, I don't even know. I looked down one day and I was like, what? I was just, I was like, what? So, you know, I was on YouTube doing all, trying to figure out all type of damage, trying to figure it out. None of it was going to work because it didn't cut on the thread. It was like just a gash. I'm not sure if it's because like, no, I got a bunion on my right foot, so it might have stretched it out a little bit. You know what I mean? But so I went on StockX to go look and see how much they were, and I was like, yeah, I'm never kidding. They were like $800-$900, and I was like, yeah.
The Bordeaux?
Bordeaux are up there. At least, last time I checked, bro, they're up there, bro.
We gotta talk when we end this. I got something about to change your life, good brother.
Thank you. I'm ready for it.
All right, y'all. Now this is what we want to get into. You know, we've chatted about hip hop, hoops, kicks, everything. Trey, this new album.
Yes.
Glory. Tell me about this album, bro. Tell me where it came from, because we were talking, God, not even a month ago, and there wasn't an album, or maybe 2 months ago. There wasn't no album.
Right.
You know, then you hit me like, yo, I'm done the album. I'm like, yo, my nigga, you didn't even have, we weren't even talking about this. So where, just give them everything about Glory. Where is this coming from? What sparked it? What did it?
Man, okay, before I get into that spiel, I was really, really trying to get this to you before this, for this broadcast, just so you can live with it before I got on here, just to see your reaction after you've heard it. But nevertheless, it really started, you know, me and Jizz had formulated the track, or should I say Jizz formulated the tracks, and I had sequenced it, you know, prior to COVID, right? We had already had the tracks laid out, how it was going to sound, all this other kind of stuff, you know, because the first intention was to write it like a book. I wanted everything to flow together, you know what I'm saying? But then COVID hit right before I could get my pen to start. So when COVID hit, it was like, damn, I ain't going to be able to go over to Jizz's crib and really record it because, you know, we in, you know what I mean? We quarantined, there's a pandemic going on.
So it was thinking about, you know, how that was going to happen. But in the meantime, I just started, the pen just started floating from there. Now, if you know me and you know my process, my pen don't float like that. Like, I'm very meticulous about, you know what I'm saying, the things that I say, what I write, you know what I mean, blah, say, blah. I'm always doing edits and all this other stuff, you know what I mean? Just being over cautious before it actually gets to the public. But in this particular case, man, again, I remember the day. It was March 13th, you know what I'm saying? Like, that's when everything, you know, kind of stopped and halted. I would say from March 13th to May, to Memorial Weekend, which was like May 24th, it was 12 songs. Just floating. It felt like my hand wasn't even on it. I know it was divine intervention. You know what I'm saying? Like, there's certain things I'll take responsibility for, like when it comes to me writing and spitting and all that. Like, yeah, I said that. I did that. You know what I mean? Some of this shit that y'all gonna hear, I don't know where it came from. Even though my hand was physically on the pen, writing it on the paper, it was clearly divine intervention. It was just something that had to be said at the time that it was said. And it's okay, so I'm a big fan of music. And I'm a big fan of the greats, your Marvins, your Curtises, your Stevies. Mm-hmm. And the thing about those cats, not only are they geniuses, but they always was tapped in to the times. You know what I'm saying? Always tapped into the times. So that's what this thing did. That's what whatever this shit was doing, it was tapped in. So it started off one way, COVID hit. You know what I'm saying? And then it went another way. And then social injustices in the street. Then it went another way. But it all melted together and it made sense at the end of the day. You know what I'm saying? So I don't know if y'all ever did this, right? This is in my college days, right? Used to get drunk and fuck with a Ouija board, right?
Yeah, I was shook at them shits. I was shook.
I do not fuck with the Ouija board.
I did it a couple times. But my point was, and the shit would never answer none of my questions. And I asked it why, and it was because this was crazy to me. It was like because of your spiritual position, meaning like is it because of my spirituality and belief in God? It was like, yep, that shit went right over the yep. But my point was, sometimes you would mess with that shit, and the thing would just move by itself. This is some creepy shit. I would never encourage the kids to do this, to play with a Ouija board, but the shit would move without your hands on it. And so I liken that to the way this fucking pen was moving. It was really some out of body shit. And I'm like, and I think I posted this. This is probably the most important album. Like, some people, you know, it's subjective. Music is subjective. Right. You're gonna like what you like, you're gonna not like what you don't like. But for me, it's the most important album at this juncture in my career. You know what I'm saying? Just based on where we are, you know what I'm saying, and where I'm thinking that we're headed to. You know what I mean? So, but I mean, we cover all bases in this joint. If you know, you're a thinker, we got that. You want to party, even though it ain't no clubs open and shit, we got that too. You want the streets, we got that too. You know, it just goes, and but that's just my MO. Going back to the first album, Many Faces, this is what we do. You know what I'm saying? So, but it's cohesive at the same time. So I'm extremely proud of it. So that's what happened, bro. 2 months.
Now, did you have the beats while you were writing, or it literally was just you had the beats?
We tracked it out and we had a sequence. We had the track sequence before I even put a pen to paper. So I had already had the soundtrack in my head. You know what I'm saying? Like, just listen to this shit over and over and over and over again. So I kind of knew, you know, the mood that I wanted to capture because I already had the background to it. So it was like, going from this story to this story to this story to this story, how are we going to connect it? Well, I already got the foundation laid because I got the music to it. So what are we going to talk about based on the music that I'm hearing? You know what I'm saying? And that was my job to do that. So again, it was 12 songs, actually 13 songs, because I didn't tell you this. There's a, I think I did Mighty Kill. We
the,
put
the
out
updated Sheesh.
Yeah, we did it. We put out Sheesh. And then I did a couple of new bars for the new Sheesh that's on this album. So it was like, you know, everything was written again, 12 songs, 13 songs in a 12-month period. And then I gave it to Jizz and that he just worked his magic. Like, this is what you guys do, Kill, producers. Right. You know what I'm saying? And the neat thing about this was, for the first time, but I'm not gonna say for the first time, but this is the first time that I've done so many songs where I've actually recorded all of my vocals on my end. So going back to how are we gonna get this done? Well, I had to record everything on my end, you know what I'm saying, through GarageBand and my Focusrite. And I got the microphone here. This is my studio right here. You see this little eight ball on here? I'm in an open basement, unfinished. Right. No booth, no nothing. But this baby right here, because of this piece right here, it feels like you're in a booth. So it was just me. I had bought a brand new computer because I didn't want nothing to distract or deter, because on my other joint, which right. still works, too much shit on there. So I was like, right. I'm going to buy a computer specifically for my music. I'm not doing anything else on it. You know what I mean?
Right.
So I bought a computer, bought that. I already had the Neumann for years, quality mic. And I recorded all my vocals on this side and then sent the sessions over to Jizz, and Jizz worked his magic on that side, and the rest is history. You know what I mean?
All right. No doubt.
I got a question. I see you had Eric Robinson on the album.
Yes.
You know what I mean? People up here don't know that Eric Robinson. So first of all, how did that hook up and end up? And also, I'm not sure, you know Demo, his backup?
Yes, absolutely.
I got a couple records with Demo.
The circle gets smaller.
So definitely. So yeah, I want to know how that come about. You know what I mean? What's your relationship with Eric Robinson?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So yeah, just touch on that for a little bit.
All right, so I'm about to give y'all an exclusive. So check it out.
This shit funny, yeah.
You heard it, Kill. Yeah, I told you. Okay, this so shit me. Funny. Me and E, we went to school together. We both went to Howard University. You know uh-huh. what I'm saying? I'm a little older than E. I came mm-hmm. in 88. E came in 92, either 91 or 92. Mm-hmm. But we've always, you know, from the time we met, you know what I'm saying, we've had, you know, crews, you know what I'm saying, at Howard University. One particular mm-hmm. crew is called Power Move, right? So in Power Move, you know, there are different groups. There's myself, who's solo MC. There's One Step Beyond, who's a three-man group.
Yo, Trey, to this day, I just got One Step Beyond, bro. Yeah, this is one of my favorite hip hop groups, and they never was signed, man.
Like, really?
I'm dead ass, man.
Always like, right there. I mean, Puff, they was like, around when Puff and was signing big. Like, Puff was on them. You know what I'm saying? Matter of fact, Sophia Chen, who was with Jive Records at the time, when you know, Tribe Called Quest and all of that, like Foosh Niggas, like they were always that close. Mm. And they was about to get signed to Universal at the time too. Kill speak on that.
One Step Beyond, man. Again, if you've heard Many Faces, Stars in the East.
Yes.
They're on that joint.
Yes.
And that is incredible, bro. Incredible. Yes. Yo, Trey, here's a funny story. I don't mean to cut you. Here's a funny story. You probably don't remember this. Rap Sheets had a demo contest uh-huh. at Howard one year for the hip hop conference down uh-huh. there. Uh-huh. And they played Stars in the East. Way really? Back then. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. No. Bunch of Stars in the East. I want to say it was, man, because you know I had so many of y'all demos back
sure,
in the day.
Sure, sure.
But y'all, I don't know what that One Step song is. They sampled Kiss of Love by Sade. Kiss of Life by Sade.
Oh, that was crazy. Oh, ah.
Yeah.
I can't think of the title.
But that was great. Yo, yeah. All I can say is this group, One Step Beyond, bro.
Incredible.
Literally one of the dopest groups Ooh. I've ever heard who never got signed. I feel like if they would have got signed, they would have been right there with all the greats. Not really? Just kind of at the bottom of the barrel.
Nah,
they were both incredible. They were like EPMD. I don't even know how they like EPMD meets Artifacts. Like, it was just, together, but I'm sorry, Trey, but whatever you say, One Step Beyond, I'm just like,
it's all good. But they were a great influence on me. So getting back to Eric Robinson. So Eric Robinson, you know, we were expanding our crew. So a lot of people didn't know that I could also sing, right? So myself, Eric Robinson, this other cat named Eric Willis, my brother Eric Willis out in L.A., my man Kevin, my man Dwayne formed a group called Mad Props. And so, you know, again, we met at Howard, then wind up doing stuff musically, and then wind up forming a group. I mean, the group was so serious, it almost got, we almost got signed by Chris Lighty. They came to a show that we was doing, and the wild shit about that is, it came to the show that we was doing, we ripped it down, and then, you know, it called us to the hotel room, and we, you know, Chris was asking us some questions, and one of the cats in the group, my man Filthy, Eric Willis, this nigga farted in the fucking, in the room. And aired it out. He aired it the fuck out. And we never heard from them niggas again.
Oh, man.
Like, in the middle, he's like, yo, why don't y'all sing something? And then he aired that shit out, and niggas was like, yo,
probably nervous as hell. He's probably nervous.
Yo.
Damn.
You ain't never heard from Chris again.
Never heard, yo, I guess they got so turned. I don't think he was nervous. I think the nigga was just, he might have been, I don't know, but he was on some other shit like that. Like, he didn't really give a fuck. The nigga just ate.
You gotta hold that down, man. You gotta hold that down. You gotta hold that down, dog.
No, he aired that shit out, and we never, I don't know if that cost us a deal, might have, but anyway. Going back to E-Roll, that's where our relationship, you know, friendship began. And, you know, we just been, you know, musically in sync and brothers ever since. Like, we've done several cuts together. So, you know, it was one of them situations where, you know, I wasn't going to bother him because, you know, E to me is the quintessential independent artist. Like,
bro, he does it.
He does it. You know what it is. Exactly. You know what it is. Like, you talk about, he's the model that I follow after, because I tell him, I call him up, be like, I'm watching your every move, son, because you do it the right way. You have your people that follow you everywhere.
He's got a loyal team. That fan base is so loyal.
It's
bro.
Crazy. It's crazy. And his show, I done seen his shows. I done seen that boy about, like, you know, after you see one motherfucker one time, it's like, all right, I get it. Right. Maybe twice.
Yeah.
No, you gotta go. It's an experience. It's not even a show.
I've been to five.
See?
Five Eric Robinson shows. He's the artist I've seen most of my life.
See? That's what I'm saying. It's an experience,
Kill. Because the first time Demo invited me to the show, and I was just like, yo, the show is fucking dope. You know what I mean? Next time Demo was in town, I brought my homeboy. Next time Demo was in town, I brought my wife. And he was at SOBs, he was at BB King's. And I'm just like, yo, these shows he puts on are outstanding. Like, he'll tell the audience, like, yo, give me four words. And I'll put a song together right then and there on the spot.
He just did a Jack and Jill show online. And I'm telling you right now, for all the artists that are trying to do, like, this is the virtual world that we live in, and this is going to be the norm. So, you know, the days of, you think you're going to go to an arena with 10,000 people in them, it ain't going to be no time soon for that shit. So you're going to have to step your game up. This dude did a show for Jack and Jill for the national organization, not just the, you know, single chapter in the city. And it was, and like, he set the bar. I believe him and Badu are setting the bar for how you're supposed to do this.
Perform.
Virtually,
yeah. Agreed.
Even if it was live, though. Like, his live shows are bananas. But great. Now you're going to have to. Like, I mean, the green screens, all that shit, people popping in and out. He had Will Downing pop in. He had, you know, Avery Sunshine pop in virtually. Mm. Like, the shit was just bananas. So, going back to how me and E met, it all goes back to Howard University. You know what I'm saying? Okay. 30 years ago.
And for those, I mean, E-Roll has a song called Howard Girls that made me want to go to Howard. I can't see it in the front. Like, that joint is.
And I read and I redid the joint on my on my ESQ album.
Oh, see, I got to. See, here's the thing. Let me say something, Trey. I didn't even know that you were still rapping.
Yeah.
One day, like a year and a half ago, Kill was like, yo, I linked up with Tracey Lee. I was like, Tracey Lee? Like, your hair happened, Tracey Lee? I was like, yeah. I gave him a haircut. I said, you gave him a haircut? I was like, he's like, yeah. He's like, yeah, he boy still rapping. He got albums out. I'm like, what? I was like, what? Like, I was like, this is crazy to me. So, I'm going to dive into the catalog
See by all means, brother. By all means, you know what I'm saying. You need me to get it to you. That's like you fam now. So
it's all good. It's all love. Yeah, definitely, most definitely.
Now, Trey, tell me this. Where's the album exclusively going to be July 31st? So when it drops next Friday, where are they going to?
Only. You can only get it at patreon.com. That's patreon.com/ Tracey Lee Music. That's the only place that you're going to be able to get it to for now. You know what I'm saying? And probably for the immediate future. You know what I mean? But okay. if you want to get that album, if you're interested in getting that album, and here's another trick I learned from Eric Robeson. Now, he had a head start because he solidified himself, blah, 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 and was able to take that fan base over to where he was. So it's really, you know, during these times and during, you know, based on what's going on and how I want our people to be able to, you know, start thinking and using their money and going straight to the source as opposed to the artist, you know, getting a middleman and the consumer going through that middleman in order to get your money to the artist. I want to, you know, begin this process of rethinking on how you support your artist. So I need to create a platform for myself in order for the true listener or, you know, person that's really into Tracey Lee to be able to come straight to me with it and not have to go to Spotify and not have to go to Tidal and not have to go to all these other vehicles, you know what I'm saying? At least right. For now, you know what I mean? So that's the only right. place you get it, patreon.com, Tracey Lee Music. Right.
No doubt. Trey, good looking for being our first guest.
Man, thank you. I'm honored, man. I'm the first one. This is the name.
You're the first guest.
The world
of
Off the top, man.
That's what's up.
Yo, before you leave, bro, you know I always want to hear a story, man, because I know you got a million of them. You've worked with, I don't know if he's yours. I know he's up there, but my number one MC ever been. You know what I'm saying?
It's always a 1A, 1B thing with me, him right. and Jay for me. So, yeah, definitely. Are we getting to big stories? I've been sitting here all day, like I'm asking a couple questions. I didn't say anything.
Yes, I'm here.
No doubt. But again, all I always do, Trey, and this is why I always tell folk on Twitter, that somebody hit me today and he was like, yo, you know, Kill, you and Porsche know so much, y'all got the podcast, I'm just a fan and I've read a couple of books. And I said, here's the problem, good brother. Never diminish being a fan.
Right.
Because that's what the culture needs more right now.
Yep.
We have too many stands. We have too many people who, you know, and people go back and forth with me about Black Thought. I have brought every Roots album ever made. I brought all 5 copies of Things Fall Apart.
I never understood that, Kel. Why are they going back and forth with you about Thought? Like, I don't understand.
But here's the thing, because people think I don't like Thought because I say he's not a good storyteller. But I'm just saying.
No, but that's going back to what you're saying. Like, these are stands. Stands right. are not going to find anything wrong or anything that's not cheerleaderish for
right.
their person.
Right.
But go ahead.
Right. But what I've said, my new rule is y'all have to take a copy. Y'all have to take a screenshot of y'all albums because y'all swallow these people. So until you can show me you done brought all the Roots discography, I don't want to hear nothing. Go, if you want to have a conversation with me, support the artist, and then we can have the conversation. But if you like, you just heard a Black Thought from Funk Flex, and you just brought Stream of Conscious 1 and 2, and not even brought them, just downloaded them. So, you know, I'm always big on supporting the artist. But, you know, what I'm saying about the fan is I know when people be like, because whenever Trey is on here, I always talk to him about how much I love this dude as an MC. You know what I mean? And I know people are like, well, can we get off Trey's dick? This happens every goddamn time. This is the thing. We grew up in an era where if you fuck with somebody, you fuck with them. You know what I mean? If they made dope music, you fuck with them. I tell people all the time, I'm still amazed to this day. Trey, you called me when the COVID shit happened. I'm amazed I could look at my phone and see Tracey Lee fucking calling me to check in on me and my family. Man. You know what I mean? Like, that's dope to me. You know what I mean?
So.
I'm saying all that to say that I always say there's only a handful of MCs. And I don't even know if it's a handful. I think it's kind of only Jay and you who kind of went toe-to-toe with Big. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like, and was right there. How did that even come about, bro? And I mean, we've been through the whole situation where how it came about, but how were you not intimidated Like, I feel like I would have been shook. Like, if you put me in the studio with, like, you know, like, I guess, like, I don't know who it is right now. Like, a Jake One. I think Jake One is just an incredible producer. Like, I would be shook to sit here and, like, program drums. Like, how did you go into the studio with a 96 Big who is, like, prime. This is, like, this is prime Big. This is prime. This is, like, prime Mike Tyson. Like, you about to spar with. You about to spar with prime Mike Tyson. And you didn't drop the ball. Like, how did, what was your mindset of, how do you go in there and do that?
All right, so, yo, y'all, you said Big and Jay is your 1A, 1B, right?
Yeah,
you
go
back
yeah.
and forth, right? Yep. So, say your phone rings right now, and it's Jay. And he says, yo, I heard that verse you put on Trade Joint. Yo, I'm going to fly you out to Cali. Once you come, I'm trying to, you know, see what's up with the record.
Say less. I'll be there shortly.
Right. So this is your 1A, 1B. Mm-hmm. I know it ain't in real time, but what would be your mind state once you got there in the studio?
I would literally, honestly, from the time I got the call, I would be locked in on a verse, on lines. I'd be coming up with lines as I'm getting ready to get in the car to get on the plane. I'm on the plane, just come up with lines. And as soon as I get in, I'm sure me and Jay gonna have a chat for about 5-10 minutes. B gonna start playing, and I'm gonna have to just be locked in and zeroed in on this verse. You know what I'm saying?
Okay.
Period. That's how I would approach it. You know what I mean?
Right. So, but in other words, you wouldn't be intimidated.
No. First of all, and listen, I'm a big believer in this, and this is with all things sports, rap. I could be scared, but you're not gonna know that.
Okay.
You're not gonna know that.
Gotcha.
I could be scared. Like, there's been times I've been on the hoop court and be like, damn, I gotta go get the dog today.
Yeah.
But you're not gonna know that. Mm-hmm. He gonna see me like, you're gonna respect me. You know what I mean?
Because you're a competitor.
And just like rap and just like basketball, as soon as the ball, it's a hoop game. As soon as he plays the beat, oh, this is rap. I gotta get to it. You know what I mean? This is like, it's the same thing. I'm sure a nigga like Jay would see me in my process and respect it. You know what I'm saying? Just like, yo, okay, beat, we're gonna talk for a little bit. I gotta act like I'm not enamored by you.
Yep.
You know what I'm saying? Even though I right here, me, Jay's dizzy in my face right here, I would be like, I'd probably be shitting my pants, but he would not know that. Right. I'm not gonna let him know that. You know what I mean? Like, yeah.
Because at the end of the day, you're a competitor.
No question. And not only that, but like, I want to have a better verse than Jay-Z, yo. Like,
yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like,
because you're a competitor.
Competitor, that's right. It is. That's what it is.
So that essentially was my approach. Mm-hmm. And to take it a step further, I'm a little older, right? I'm actually older than Big. You know what I'm saying? I'm older than these cats. Like, I just to put it in context, you know, I started rhyming in 82. I was 12 years old. I was actively trying to get deals since 85. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Sending demo tapes and all that. So by the time 96, 97 rolls around, it's like I'm already seasoned and been seasoned for the last 15 years.
Yeah.
So I feel like all these cats is getting on before me. Like, how the hell they got on? How he get on? How he get into it? I felt the same way about Big. I felt the same way about Jay. I felt the same way about all of them because I was rhyming. I felt like I was rhyming and ill way before they were. So when I get in there with Big, I understand, you know, what's going on. I understand who he is. And it's an honor and a privilege because he is at the top of the food chain. He is at the time the illest cat that's out there on the streets and in radio. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, and as a matter of fact, I'm humbled by the fact that, you know, he wanted to do a record with me, and I think he's partly responsible for me actually getting signed because Mark Pitts, who's the cat that actually signed me, you know what I'm saying, who is responsible for the Chris Browns and the J. Coles and the Ushers and all these other cats of the world, you know what I'm saying, and manages Big at the time, is playing my demos while Big is in the car, looking for that cosign other than D-Dot, who actually brought me to the table. So he's listening to the records with Big, the demos, and Big is like, yo, your man is nice. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, I'm humbled by this.
That's crazy. I'm sorry. Yo, what?
Oh, man. I go, listen, Trey, I go sit here live. Like, when you and Goon were on IG Live the other day, Yeah. And when y'all said my verse was hard, I literally was smiling ear to ear. So you telling me Big is telling somebody like, yo, your man is Big saying like, yo, your man is nice. I wouldn't do it myself, bruh.
Yeah, here's the crazy thing, and I always tell people this. L-Rock's demos, Tracey Lee, L-Rock's demos, bruh, they were fucking albums. That's what I'm saying about when they was at Howard. Like, songs that were on his demo made the album. When you think about the average MC who's coming up in the 90s, their demos aren't even worthy enough to be close to be on the album. But this is what I mean about their demos. So it was like they were already making albums without a label, without an A&R, without none of that, with no big name producers or nothing. The beats was crazy. And I told you, B, playing his demo at Morgan got New York niggas to be like, yo, Philly got some shit.
Philly got some shit.
Wow. Philly got some shit. That before thought, because it was Illadelphia really made a lot of New York niggas be like, yo. But before that, L-Rock's demos, trust me, was all throughout Morgan's whole campus. So it sounds crazy when people who haven't heard those demos hear Big say, yo, your man is nice. It made all the sense in the world because those demos were album worthy. That they made the fucking album. Like, that's the moral to the story. Like, Songs in the East, or, you know, Living on the Edge. These were demos that made the album. You know what I mean? So
the Rugged One.
Yeah,
Yeah.
Yo, yeah. So they said you're nice. Your man is nice.
And so I'm humbled by that because this is, again, he's at the top of the food chain. But at the end of the day, like you say, y'all, when you get into the studio and when you get into the booth and when you hear the beat, when you hear the track playing, it's all right, I know who you are. I see the Coogee, you know what I'm saying? I see all that. We having discussions, you telling me, you giving me all these jewels about the game, and it's greatly appreciated because I need that, man. You didn't have to share that with me. So I need that and thank you. But at the end of the day, and as now, okay. I'm the elder statesman here because, nigga, I got you by a year or two. Mm-hmm. I'm about to eat you alive. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? But we're gonna make a great record. But I'm an MC first. And I can't, it's my album. I can't allow you to come on my album and just shit on me.
No, it's not happening. Right.
You're not gonna do that. I don't care who you are. You're just not gonna do that. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Like, we MCs at the end of the day. I love you. But we MCs at the end of the day. And so you have to put your best foot forward. I don't care who it is. And I don't care where they are in their, you know, as far as their skill level. I'm coming with it.
Mm-hmm. Period.
So that was essentially my attitude. You know what I'm saying? That was essentially my attitude. And, you know, the end result is the end result. And I thank Big immensely for that because he didn't have to do that. You know what I'm saying? There's a lot of cats that wouldn't do that, even now. I'm not rhyming with him. Nigga ain't got no track record. He ain't ever, you know what I mean? Like, nah, I'm not doing
that. Another thing is I feel like Big just like to rhyme. I just feel like if he fucks with you, he's like, I just like to rhyme.
Yeah.
So let's rhyme. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah. It was a sport to him. Yeah. But here's the thing. Here's the other form of flattery that I must say. There's a lot of people that say that those bars on that record are probably Big's best bar ever.
Dog,
I was just about to say that.
I tweeted this shit today. Today, because there's a stretch in there where he's like, I thought your jewels was rented.
Yeah.
But they wasn't.
Yeah.
So run them, cousin. I was telling niggas like, yo, there's certain shit about rap, like Big, that makes him the natural. He's the natural.
He's the natural.
Then what did he say after that? He was like, I could chill, but my heat doesn't. It's like, nigga, what?
Ran up in your shell about a dozen.
You ain't see Ben like
Frank White.
Yo, and that's the thing. It's like, I tell killers all the time, there's no format with Big.
Nope.
There's no, like, structure. Nope. You know what I'm saying? And it's like, wait, nigga. Like, that bar is not supposed to rhyme here, but you completely switched it and made the half bar. I was like, it's like a puzzle for this nigga. He's just placing the pieces. You know what I'm saying? I'll tag you in a tweet because I tweeted today. I was like, this is what I'm talking about with Big. Like, nobody can do this. You know what I'm saying? Like,
And so that just told me that you felt like based on I'm gonna assume that it was based on the level that I was coming with, that you felt like, especially in that second, you know, me and my nigga Lance, me and my nigga Lance, because he heard my footsteps, so he's like, "Oh, this nigga's not playing.
Okay. We not playing." Me and my nigga Lance, and he started going. Hey, I love the first verse more. I love Big's first verse. I love the first part of Big's verse, first part of the song from Big more. But the second, when he started blacking about, like,
I know what that was. But if you, y'all, if you was in the studio, I'm telling you where that was coming from. That was coming from, like, again, when somebody, you know, when you playing ball, right? And somebody is like giving it to you, and you know you got the skill set to be like, all right, this nigga's not fucking around.
Yeah, I got to take it down. I got to take it down. I got to get back in the bag.
That's exactly where that second, because it was personal. Yeah. You listen to that second verse, he got personal. It started releasing
energy
that nobody knew.
Yeah.
That shit was real shit. Me and my nigga Lance took Kim and Season fans, bought 10 bricks, 4 pounds of weed brand fans from Branson, now we lamping. Like, all that shit was factual shit that nobody ever heard before.
Four plants from Branson. I wonder if Branson's still around selling weed, bro.
He just did a documentary.
I call it Trey. It's a documentary on Netflix.
I'll check it out tomorrow.
And he mentions this session that we're talking about.
That's crazy.
Talking about Big cannot, he couldn't start that session until I brought that shit over to that Tracey Lee session.
That's crazy.
You see what I'm saying?
That's crazy.
So I say all that to say, you know, nah, I wasn't intimidated. It was competition. It was all out of love. And we accomplished what we wanted to, was make, you know, at least in our eyes, a classic record.
Yeah, and you did that.
So.
Yeah, I know you had something else you wanted to ask, right?
I mean, honestly, it was like, the same thing about the studio. It's going to sound crazy, but yo, what did Big order to eat? What was he drinking? You know what I'm saying? Like, what was he wearing? Like, what chicks came to the studio to come check you? Like, I want to know it all. All
right, I'm gonna break it down for you, y'all. Cause y'all, you never heard this story. So
nah.
So I walk in. We in D&D Studios, right?
Recorded in, which is crazy. Okay,
yeah, you know what I'm saying? So shout out to Primo. Uh-huh. I know Big and them is already in there before I get in there. So when I say Big and them, I walk in there, it's Big, and it's a Can't Knock the Hustle Jay-Z in there with his black mink on. I knew he was going to do that. So Jay's in there. This is the first time I met Jay. You know what I'm saying? He gave me the fucking three-finger handshake, which I thought was disrespectful.
I heard he does that. He used to do that a lot.
He was
like, yo, get out of here. Like, what are you doing?
Manicured hands and shit, baby cough and shit. Like, you know what it is. Shout out to Jay though. You know what I mean? But he know what it is. But anyway, he's still a can knock the hustle mode, you know, blah blah blah. Cause here's a nugget too, because at the time, Mark was also trying to negotiate a situation with me and Jay can get on the record. You know what I'm saying? But Jay was like, yo, what are me and Boy gonna talk about? Because again, he's in Can't Knock the Hustle mode. So I guess he felt like I wasn't doing that. So I don't know what the situation was. But anyway, came in, and I think that was part of the reason why he was there. You know what I'm saying? So then after a while, I step in there, he steps out. So it's just me, Big, you know, my people's blah, blah, blah. And so it's about an 8-hour session because we're really kind of writing this on the fly. You know what I mean? And so Big is in the corner. And he got the, this is what he ordered. He ordered Hennessy and he ordered Branson.
That's it.
That's Hennessy, all I saw.
Hennessy and Tree, my man.
You know what I mean?
God damn, all right.
He's consistent.
Yeah.
He had on the signature Coogee, you know what I mean? Sitting in the corner and, you know, we laughing and joking the whole time. He dropping jewels, he giving all types of game, blah, blah, blah. But ever so often, he would black out. He would come out of the conversation. He's sitting in his chair. Because if you remember,
This is shortly after Ben got into the accident.
Yeah. Right. So he was limping a little bit.
Yeah, so matter of fact, he recorded the session sitting down because he couldn't stand up, you know what I mean? So he was sitting in a chair, and ever so often after us having a conversation, he'll sit back in that chair and just black out, and just you'll just see his body doing this as the beats in the background rolling. He'll come back, laugh, joke, smoke, blah, 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 ha, 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 you know what I mean? Then he'll sit back and you see him doing this. You see him doing this. And so he does this shit. After a while, I'm looking over at him like, yo, boy, what are you doing? He's like, yo, 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 chill, chill, chill. All right. So he comes back in. Then 8 hours later, he's like, okay, I'm ready. I didn't see a pen, I didn't see a pad, I didn't see nothing. I said, ready for what? What are you talking about? You ready? Like, I'm ready to get in the booth. I was like, where's your pen and your pad? Because at that time, I was, you know. Yeah. He was like, nah, Trey, nah, I can't. I was like, what do you mean? He's like, it confuses me. And I didn't understand what he was talking about when he was saying it confuses me. So, nevertheless, he goes in there, does an incredible, you know, and I'm thinking at first he's going freestyle, meaning off the top, meaning he just gonna hit a beat and just start spitting these rhymes, but actually the whole time he's writing in his head.
And it makes sense that he would do that because why he would say the paper confuses him, because dog, the way he puts his bars together, how could you write that shit down? I even said when I was like, look at the way this shit is written and then listen to the way it's spit. Yep. This shit is incredible.
Yep.
You know what I mean?
Yep. Yep. And he's cutting out the middleman. So to go from here, transfer it to paper, then transfer it to the mic, you're not going to get all the flows, the cadences, because you study trying to read it and learn it. Yeah. And all. Nah, he's learning it as he goes along so that when he gets in there, he's already into the rhythm because all he was doing when he was doing this, getting in the pockets.
That's it.
He's getting in the pockets. Yep.
In the pockets.
Making sure the syllables are aligned, blah, blah, blah. All that, this is the process.
Yeah.
So when he gets in the joint, even though he's doing it like in four bars, okay, punch me in four bars, six bars here, he knows exactly how he wants to say it, where he wants everything to sit, blahzy blah, all the way down. So I just gave you the short version of that studio session. That's crazy.
That's history in the making right there, good brother. That's history. And again, the beautiful thing, bro, is that, again, you go down as one of the few MCs. And I guess it's really just you and Jay who can really honestly say they went bar for bar.
You don't think meth? Big. You don't think meth?
I'll say meth.
Yeah. I forgot about the what.
I'll say meth. I will also say the brat.
I like the brat.
Like now, I'll say this.
She held her own. She held her own on that record, though.
I like
Big.
The brat.
She held her own with Big on that record.
I'll say this. The what meth? The what? You know what it is? Because Ready to Die is one of those strange albums. That and Black Moon's first album, they're strange to me because you could tell with Black Moon's first album, when you hear Who Got the Props, you could tell they first recorded it. That was one of the first songs they did. When you hear How Many MCs, you could tell that that's a whole nother Buck. That's when Buck got into his flow. Same thing with Ready to Die. When you hear Machine Gun Funk Big and when you hear Warning Big, that's different than the Unbelievable Big. Mm-hmm. That we got. So you can see Unbelievable was kind of like one of the last songs made, and that was forging the way into the next big that was to come. That's me personally, I like the post Unbelievable Big. I like that big better than the Give Me the Loop Big. I feel like the what big, Meth was fine with that. I'm talking about Big when Big Unbelievable Big, that's when I was like,
when he peaked.
He could be the good, when we're talking about running L at his pinnacle,
yes.
To me, that's Big at his pinnacle. So
I
to me, Meth got was with Big, but not at Big's pinnacle.
You know what I mean?
Big was at his pinnacle, I'm looking at you and Jay. You know what I mean? On Brooklyn's Finest and I Love the Dough. You know what I mean? And then you would keep the hands high. So to me, Big at his pinnacle, to me, is just you and Jay, which is incredible to say.
I mean, I'm just in that company, but at the same time, you know, as an MC, you know, just speaking from a, you know, vibrato standpoint, you know, I feel like I belong in that company, but, you know, just me being, you know, me, I'm very humbled to be in that company, you know what I'm saying?
Right. One more thing before you go, bro, because you said this to me and it got me hyped, man. Are you still releasing the shelf, the album?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. This dude had a shelved album, man. Let me explain something to you again, ahead of their time. Because what? I told you I was on a podcast with a person in London. I brought up your name. He's like, oh, God, I love Tracey. You know what I mean? Many faces. This was T.I. versus Tip before T.I. versus Tip, mm-hmm. everything like that. Yo, Yao, this boy had a song. What's it called on Trey? You know what I'm always talking about. Can't Win for Losing.
Catch 22.
Yeah. This was Streets is Watching. Before Streets is Watching. Mm. This was, if I shoot you, I'm brainless. If you shoot me, you're famous. Mm-hmm. What's the nigga to do? Mm-hmm. Trey was breaking down. My old head Steve is how I met Trey at Howard. I'm on Ogun's Avenue with Steve, and he's playing me these joints. Incredible, bro. He's talking about, yo, if I don't smash the chick, I'm the gay rapper. If I smash the chick, I'm getting, you know, accused of rape. You know what I mean? If, you know, somebody try to rob me and they rob me, I'm a punk. But if I shoot them, then I go to jail. Like, it was this, yo, bro. Amazing. And I'm like, yo, this nigga Trey is a fucking monster. And you know what I mean? So, and like I said, it was like literally when I heard Streets is Watching, I was like, that first line from Jay, I'm like, yo, that's Trey shit right there. Like that whole concept was Trey, you know. But you're still releasing this album. And talk just a little bit about this album, the producers who you had on this album and everything like that.
Catch 22 was actually supposed to be the second release off of Universal after Many Faces. You know, it kept getting pushed back because, you know, you had the likes of Nelly coming into the fold and Cash Money coming into the fold. So a lot of the time and attention and money was going towards them. So we still had a budget to make that second album, but the second album never materialized, meaning it never got dropped. It was completed, but never got, you know, put out there. And I was eventually dropped shortly thereafter. Mm-hmm. But we had a young Kanye produce two records on that album.
Damn.
We had Buckshot on that album. We got Corrupt on that album. We got Black Rob on that album. Myself and D-Dot oversaw everything that's on this particular project. And I mean, sonically and again, it highlights, I got different sides. Like, Many Faces was some real shit when it comes to my approach to music. You know what I'm saying? It's really about a feel, and it's really about who I am at that particular time. So this particular album really got to the chase of, it really got to the street shit. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Like, because there was a period in my life where that's what it was. So it really got to the street shit, and that's really the kind of shit that I was talking about on this album. Now, would I be doing that now? Hell no. And there's certain things that I'm not too proud of, but that's just where I was at that
point. At the time, yeah. Right.
But sonically, and you know, rhymes, you know, the rhymes are there. Like, it's really, like Kill's saying, it's a gem, man, and it's something that I feel like people need to hear and people need to understand, because I think it'll give you a better perspective of who I am and where I came from. You see what I'm saying? So, we definitely gonna drop that on Patreon.com only.
Got you.
All right.
You know what I'm saying? So make sure the people understand it only on Patreon.
Right, right, right. Yeah, it's crazy, bro. We did an episode of Apartment 5B about shelved albums. You know what I mean? Mm. And how many shelved albums would have shifted the way we look at so many MCs. Mm. You know what I mean? Like, you know, Lawrence Professor's first album, the LP, if that would have dropped in 95, 96 when it was supposed to, I think it would have took Extra P to a whole nother level. But like you said, at that time, Bad Boy was winning, so a whole SP-1200 gutter drums, that the labels didn't know what to do with that. Mm. You know what I mean? So you just end up shelving this album. You know what I mean? So there's so many shelved albums that I think if they would have been able to get dropped and they would have been able to be released, that we would talk about so many of these MCs in such a bigger way. You know what I mean?
Absolutely.
It's almost like for a movie heads watching, it's like people keep wanting the Snyder cut of the Justice League. You know what I mean? Like, that's to me what hip hop is. It's like, if you were able to hear these L Rock songs back in 93 when I heard them, people would understand why I champion Trey so much. Mm-hmm. Because his demos were right there with everything else the fuck that was coming out in 93, 94. Mm. Now, y'all gotta understand me. I hosted Strictly Hip Hop at Morgan State for 7 years. I've fucking been around this game. So for me to tell you that L Rock was right there, his demos were right there with the Midnight Marauders, the Into the Woos, the Black Moons, it was right there with it. it would have fit right into the mix. But because, you know, people didn't get signed or people got, you know, got released from deals or whatever. So it's just, it's hard to really see the whole format of hip hop because of these labels and because of people getting dropped and all those things like that. So just to say all that to say, man, yo, this dude, if you don't know, one of the nicest. I'm not just saying this because he's from Philly.
And killing, that's why I continue to make music, because it ain't just, you know, you may have missed that period in time when I was doing, this is for the people that don't know who I am. You may have missed that period of time. I'm glad you're here to articulate it, you know, someone other than me. But this is why I continue to make it, because I'm going to continue to do this for as long as I'm breathing. So you will be able to catch a period in which you're saying, oh, Trey Lee is nice. It may not have been 90 something Trey Lee, but the 2020 Trey Lee. Or right. 2040 Trey Lee. Nigga, I'm doing this until the wheels fall off. Mm-hmm. So right. I just felt like this is the gift that God gave me, so I will continue to serve and give back to our culture the way it was given to me in a gift form. And so that everybody has, you know, an opportunity to see that this is what it is. You know what
Amen. No doubt. Trey, let them know where they can get at you.
Yes.
Twitter, IG, everything. The album next week, everything.
Yes. All right. So you always can go to IG, Tracey Lee ESQ, TRACEYLEESQ. You can catch me on Twitter, TRAYLEE. And then again, TraceyLeeMusic.com is the website. And then Patreon.com/TraceyLeeMusic is the only place that you'll be able to get this new heat produced by OJs entitled Glory, dropping January 31st. 2020, which is next Friday. You dig?
No doubt. Here's the wild part, bro. I'm on IG scrolling. I come across RJ Payne joining. You got a joint with Payne?
Shout out to my brother RJ Payne, one of the illest cats that's out there right now. If y'all ain't up on him, you're missing. You're really missing out.
Yeah.
It's one of the illest cats out there, man. But
so you got a joint on his new joint?
He kept this in the can, yo. Like, we did this record, you know, a year back. I ain't going to tell you when because it don't even matter. But he kept it in the can, and I didn't even know he was going to put it out. And then lo and behold, I'm looking at the Twitter feed. Yeah, new RJ, Lord Tariq, you know what I'm saying? And featuring Lord Tariq and Trey Lee. I'm like, oh, he dropped it. And he don't even know. Thank you, brother. But it's bringing his base now, trying to find out, okay, cool, Trey Lee.
Who's Trey Lee? Yeah.
Just in the nick of time, because I'm about to drop an album. So it's like,
right.
You see how this all this shit aligned?
Go up next.
It's crazy. Right. God is crazy, man. So thank you. Thank you, brother. Listen, it's called Take a Risk. It's ill and it's timely. It's timely. Have you heard it yet, Kill?
Nah, I haven't. I literally, before we started this show, I'm just on IG and I'm like, whoa, like,
yeah,
okay.
Yeah. Y'all and Kill, you check it out.
Right after the show, definitely.
It's crazy. Yeah. So, yo, shout out to RJ Payne. That's my brother. And I represent him on a couple of things on the legal side, and we ain't even getting into all that. In case y'all didn't know, I'm an attorney as well. So.
Yeah.
No doubt. Yao, let them know where they can get at you, good brother.
Yo, man, Yao G's Music, YAWGEEZ Music. I'm on IG, I'm on Twitter. I fuck with Facebook a little bit. I'm trying. That's for the, older folks. I'm
like
out
me,
on,
like me.
You know what I mean? Like my OG, Trey Lee here. So got to join the remix of Sheesh.
Absolutely.
It's on SoundCloud right now.
Yes.
Kills page. Got an album that's still running. You're all welcome. That's on all digital platforms. Working on some new music, mixtape, EP, album, what do you want to call it? Called Back to the Basement.
All right.
Bar Heavy. Got some special features on there as well. So we'll see what happens.
I'm on it.
Say less, Trey. Say less. And yeah, that's it, man. Holla at me.
All right, and y'all already know this with me, Kill Apartment 5B on Twitter, Kill889 on IG, We'll Make Beats for Food.com. Yo, first show, dope show, off the top. If you want to know about hip-hop, sneakers, and hoops, this is the spot to be. I will definitely check y'all next week, y'all.
Peace.
All right?